We acknowledge that we gather for our work on the traditional territories of the Neutral Tribes, Erie, Huron, and the other Native peoples who followed them as the original nations of this land. And we acknowledge with respect their history, their spirituality, and their culture. Hello. I'd like to extend a warm welcome to each one of you for joining us at Grace United Church in Burlington. May you be uplifted and comforted by the Word of God as we worship together.
Welcome to our Thanksgiving worship. I want to start with giving thanks for those who supported our shredding event last Saturday. Your hard work, your time and energy are greatly appreciated. For upcoming events, please check out our newest Use You Can Use video on YouTube. In your time, Creator God, this world was put in place, and in your time it became beautiful through the craftsmanship of your love. We light our candles today to be reminded that you separated light from darkness, the waters and the earth. Remind us always as we look at sunrise, landscape, or tiny child to look beyond the artist's brush or the created thing to the artist and creator. Let us come before God with worship. Thanksgiving is not just a moment, not just a day, nor just a season. Thanksgiving is an action, to be lived as an attitude, a promise, a life. In deep gratitude, we come to worship God, recognizing God is the source of all goodness. Throughout our lives, God has blessed us with love and with hope. All good gifts come through the Spirit of God. Love, peace, joy, patience, kindness, and gentleness. May our hearts be truly grateful today, and may we show our gratitude by the ways in which we live and care for others. Let us enter this time of worship giving thanks for one another, for all creation, and for the Creator of all. Let us worship God.
Yeah. let us gather in prayer. Generous and extravagant God, creator of all things, we come to you this morning with thankful hearts for all your gifts to us and to your people everywhere. We think about the amazing beauty of the world you have made and this majestic, yet fragile land we call our home. As we worship together, remind us of the sacredness of all creation. Remind us of our responsibility to respect the ways of the earth and the connections between all things. We continue in prayer together, repeating the words Jesus taught as we pray together.
For our learning time today, I'd like to tell you the story about Cuthbert, the eagle and the fish. Cuthbert was a famous saint from Northern England who lived many, many years ago. One day he set off with a young lad who was his attendant, and they went wandering through the countryside. And as the day grew on, they started to get hungry. It was getting to be lunchtime, but they hadn't packed any food. So St. Cuthbert turns to the young boy and says, "Do you know anybody along this road?" He says, no, I don't know anybody along this road. But St. Cuthbert says, "Hang in there, don't worry about it. God will provide." St. Cuthbert then sees an eagle flying overhead and says, "See that eagle? Follow where she flies." So the boy follows the eagle. The eagle swooped down and grabbed a fish out of the stream, landed on a rock nearby, and then put the fish in front of her. The boy went and grabbed the fish and brought it to St. Cuthbert. And St. Cuthbert got really upset. "Why did you do that? Why did you bring me the whole fish? Go back, split the fish in half. We can't take it all. We need to, out of thanksgiving, give something back." And that's kind of what Thanksgiving is all about, knowing that it's out of our gratitude and out of recognizing that everything we have isn't because of our doing, it's a gift that we then give back. So let us continue to worship as we think about gratitude and how God has been so gracious in our lives.
For the fruit of all creation, thanks be to God. For the gifts to every creation, sharing God.
The reading today is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 to 15. The point is this: the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each of you must give as you have made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work. As it is written, he scatters abroad, he gives to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for your great generosity, which will produce thanksgiving to God through us. For the rendering of this ministry not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also overflows with many thanksgivings to God. Through the testing of this ministry, you glorify God by your obedience to the confession of the gospel of Christ, and by the generosity of your sharing with them and with all others, while they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God that he has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift.
I'm reading today from Luke chapter 17, verses 11 to 19. 10 healed, one returns to offer thanks. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well."
Let us come before God with prayer. As we worship you, God, we want everything to be for your glory. We want our thoughts, our words, our songs, our church, our community, our resources, our time, our lives, all to be for you. Bless our time of hearing and reflection. May the words spoken and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, as we continue with thanksgiving and with praise. Amen. A husband and wife, Ole and Lena, died and went to heaven. There they were delighted to find a fabulous golf course, like no other golf course they'd ever seen. "I bet it costs an arm and a leg to belong to this club," said Ole. "Oh no," said a nearby angel. "Club memberships are free to all residents of heaven." "Well then," Ole continued, "the green fees must be astronomical." "No," said the angel, "the green fees have all been paid as well." At which point, Ole turned to Lena. "This is such a wonderful golf course. Just think, if you hadn't made me eat all that oat bran, we could have started enjoying it 12 years ago." We humans are a funny bunch, aren't we? The grass is always greener on the other side. Thomas Merton put it this way: we are not satisfied with what is currently our situation because we have it on our mind that our life won't be happy until something else occurs. Whatever blessings we receive, we dwell on what we might have missed. Today we celebrate Thanksgiving, our annual celebration of gratitude, where we're challenged to stop for a time, to contemplate the people, the things, the experiences that enrich our lives. The neat thing is that gratitude is good for us. It's been said that gratitude is one of the strongest and most transformative states of being. It shifts our perspective from lack to abundance and allows us to focus on the good in our lives, which in turn pulls more goodness into our reality. Researchers once followed 170 college students for 3 weeks around the time of Thanksgiving, tracking gratitude, positive effect, and life satisfaction. researchers saw a significant bump in both gratitude and positive effect on Thanksgiving Day. However, without the infusion of practicing gratitude, life satisfaction and meaning in life plummeted. So, with gratitude being good for us, one might think we'd focus that way all the time. But students of Scripture know that more than anything else, we humans battle fear. And we know this because one of the most frequent assurances that we hear from God and from Jesus are the words, "Fear not," or "Be not afraid." And we often fear not having enough and not being enough. Once upon a time, a thirsty hiker lucked out by finding an abandoned house. Finding an old pump, he proceeded to pump with all the strength he had left. No water came out. Then he saw a small jug with a cork on top and a penciled note directing that the water in the jug be poured into the pump to prime it. At first, the thirsty man was tempted to just swig down the contents of the jug. But when he followed the directions, he obtained refreshing water in an even greater quantity. Before going his way, he refilled the jug with water for the next person, adding to the note, "Believe me, it really works. You have to give it all away before you can get anything back." The hiker puts into action the words that Paul spoke to the early church in Corinth when he said, "God is able to provide you with every blessing in abundance, so that by always having enough of everything, you may share abundantly in every good work." We know some people don't always work from a sense of abundance. Some come from scarcity. But a sense of scarcity and abundance don't actually have to do with the person's wealth or circumstance. It's more about attitude. Wayne Dyer suggested that abundance is not something we acquire. It's something we tune into. Maybe that's why Canada's poorest province, Newfoundland, is known for hospitality and are considered amongst the most generous givers. And in the western provinces, I learned something about this when I was in Saskatchewan Conference serving on the finance committee, learning how to predict givings to mission. If farmers had good crops and more wealth, givings went down. But if crops were poor and it was a tough year, givings to mission went up. So people with less money gave more. Over the years, I've questioned if it's easier to let go and trust God when we're already feeling vulnerable. Maybe it's then that we realize just how dependent we are on God. Or maybe when we're down, we have more empathy and consideration of others who are facing even greater challenges than we are. Over the years, I came to understand Saskatchewan was the land of "it will be better next year." They seem to understand inherently that the key to abundance is meeting limited circumstances with unlimited thoughts. Sometimes we humans get confused by the difference of being blessed and being privileged. A privilege is something a particular group of people has, which is not had or enjoyed by all. A blessing, on the other hand, is an undeserved gift, which has nothing to do with merit. It cannot be earned, nor is it a right. And sometimes we've enjoyed blessings so often and so frequently, we forget they're blessings, and we begin to expect them as a right. For example, many in our congregation have experienced the blessings of a good marriage. And often there's a tendency to take the goodness of our spouses for granted. When someone does nice things for us, even little things, over and over again, we become used to them. In fact, we become so used to them, we start to expect them. And in expecting them, we can often lose a sense of appreciation and gratitude. Famous preacher Gilbert Chesterton suggested that when it comes to life, the critical thing is whether you take things for granted or take them with gratitude. Today in the Gospels, we heard the story of Jesus healing the 10 lepers. Leprosy in biblical times was a most feared disease, which tore at the body, causing infection and mutilation. It was highly contagious and was treated by physically isolating the afflicted, separating them from society as untouchable. Even well into the Middle Ages, people with leprosy had to shake bells or shout unclean ahead of them as they walked a distance away from the main roads. The lepers that Jesus meets are social outcasts considered cursed and unclean. They can't approach Jesus, so they start shouting at him. And Jesus doesn't ask them any questions. He doesn't berate them for who they are. Jesus simply tells them, "Go, show yourselves to the temple priest." Now, 9 of the folks, we can assume, are Jews, because they proceed to the temple priest to be made ritually clean, knowing that only then will they be able to return to society. It's the priests who can change their social status, providing them with entry back into the lives they once knew. Imagine the joy of suddenly being made whole again, of being able to go home, to resume the life with community and family and friends that you once had. But only one of the 10 lepers that had been healed, well, he turned around to say thank you. All we know that distinguishes the thankful person is that he was a Samaritan. When Jesus said, "Go to the priests," this man knew he would be considered an outsider because of his birthplace, his nationality, his differing religious practices. He would be ineligible to turn to the priests. In fact, the priests actually reviled him, and they would allow him no grace, no love, no acceptance. Even though healed, he would not be welcome in the temple. So even after healing, he was on his own, healed from leprosy, but not from the effects of being an outsider. His cohorts are now gone, and really all he has left is Jesus. So being healed, he turns back praising God with a loud voice, and he prostrates himself at Jesus' feet and thanks him. Now let's take a moment to do the math. Well, 10 were healed, 1 was thankful, but how many were blessed? All 10 were very religious when they needed God, shouting out to Jesus, "Heal us, Lord, heal us, we need you." When they needed God, they were close to God. But for 9 of them, when they didn't need God, they were busy off being well. So the irony is, once the crisis is over, the healing miracle left those who were healed further away from God. The 9 demonstrate that the real test of our faith and gratitude comes not when we're suffering, but when things are actually going well. When everything's going our way, we tend to take God for granted. When you think about it, they got the healing, but not the healer. They experienced a miracle, but not the miracle worker. They received the gift, but didn't stay in relationship and love the giver. So the 9 tragically missed the true blessing. In some respects, it's not surprising that the thankful one was a stranger. Often it's an outsider with a different perspective that's best able to show us a different view of reality. One afternoon, a shopper at a local mall felt a need for a coffee, so she brought herself a little bag of cookies and put them in her shopping bag. She got in line for her coffee, found a place to sit in one of the crowded tables, and then taking out a magazine, she began to sip her coffee and read. Across the table from her, a man sat reading a newspaper. After a minute or two, she reached out to the bag of cookies and took one. As she did, the man seated across the table reached out and took one too. This annoyed her, but she didn't say anything. A few minutes later, she took another cookie. Once again, the man did so too. Now she was getting a bit upset, but she still didn't say anything. After having a couple of sips of her coffee once again, she took another cookie. So did the man. Now she was really upset, especially since now there was only one cookie left. The man also realized that only one cookie was left. And before she could say anything, he took it, broke it in half, offered her half, and proceeded to eat the other half himself. Then he smiled at her, and putting the paper under his arm, rose and walked away. She was steamed. Her coffee break was ruined, and she started to think how she would ever tell this story to her family. She folded her magazine, opened her shopping bag, and there she discovered a bag of unopened cookies. This Thanksgiving, I'm guessing many are identifying with the 10 people with leprosy before they met Jesus and were healed. Many are tiring of isolation and yearning to gather with family and friends. Like Easter, we're grieving not being able to celebrate following normal patterns. At the same time, our scriptures today challenge us to remember gratitude and thanksgiving are a choice rather than a state of being. Melody Beattie suggests that gratitude unlocks the fullness of life. It turns what we have into enough and more. It turns denial into acceptance, chaos to order, confusion to clarity. It can turn a meal into a feast, a house into a home, a stranger into a friend. Gratitude makes sense of our past, brings peace for today, and creates a vision for tomorrow. The challenge for us is to focus not so much on the trappings, but the core of our Thanksgiving tradition. There's nothing stopping any of us from choosing to practice gratitude this holiday weekend. Saying a thankful prayer, core to our rituals, can be done equally well alone or in a crowd. At home, at church, maybe in a park or in the hospital, wherever we find ourselves this weekend, we have the ability to pray thank you. If we're really honest, family holidays can actually bring us, yes, joy, but it can also be kind of stressful. Whether it's traveling or family conflicts or the pressure of cooking the perfect meal, we can kind of get stressed out with these holidays. Every other year, in spite of those stresses though, most of us choose to be grateful. So maybe this year, we just have different stresses. Henry Van Dyke suggested that gratitude is the inward feeling of kindness received. Thankfulness is the natural impulse to express that feeling. Thanksgiving is the following of that impulse. So this year, I invite you to spend some time identifying what and who you are grateful for in 2020. Think about the things that make you smile. If you need a boost, you don't have to travel too far to see some spectacular leaves. Mother Nature is having a particularly awesome fall this year. So notice it and enjoy it. It helps lift up my spirits for sure. Take time to reflect on why you're grateful for a particular person, then phone or email or write them to let them know you appreciate them. William Ward suggested that feeling gratitude and not expressing it is like wrapping a present and then not giving it. This Thanksgiving, may we intentionally take time to be more aware than ever of the gifts we've received. When we are grateful for the abundance that's present, love, health, family, friends, work, the joys of nature, and personal pursuits that bring us pleasure, the wasteland of illusion falls away, and we can experience heaven on earth. So may we choose gratitude and remember, all is gift, all is grace, all is good. Amen.
Gather their yield, the long hours of labor, the skills. An Iroquois prayer of thanksgiving. We return thanks to our Mother the Earth, which sustains us.
We return thanks to the rivers, streams, and lakes, which supply us with food and water.
We return thanks to all herbs, weeds, and bushes, which furnish us with medicines for the cure of our diseases.
We return thanks to the corn and to her sisters, the beans and the squashes, which give us life.
We return thanks to the bushes and trees, which provide us with fruit and shelter.
We return thanks to the animals, which provide us with meat and skins.
We return thanks to the wind, which moves the air, banishes diseases.
We return thanks to the moon and the stars, which have given us their light when the sun has gone.
We return thanks to the sun, that he has looked upon the earth with a beneficent eye and given us heat and light.
Lastly, we return thanks to the Great Spirit, in whom is embodied all the goodness, and who directs all things for the good of his children. Amen.
As we enter into a time of gratitude, let us remember that this is how the earth praises God, giving thanks for God's abundance. The meadows clothe themselves with flocks. The valleys deck themselves with shimmering fields of grain, sharing their bounty with the rest of creation. We too are to worship God by being abundant and fruitful with our lives, offering up our yields as if they were songs of joyful praise. Let us worship God as we ask for blessings upon our gifts.
Grateful.
Let us pray a prayer of dedication. God of all creation, thank you for wonderful things that you have made. Thank you for the universe full of stars and planets. Thank you for our world full of life. Thank you for making each one of us. Thank you for loving each one of us. For the ways you provide for us, we say thank you. For the opportunity to give, we say thank you. For the kingdom work our offerings will do, we say thank you. For letting us be part of your work, we say thank you. We offer ourselves and all gifts you've blessed us with. Take us and use us to share our love with the world. May our hands reach out in service, our feet walk in the path of reconciliation, and our words be words of peace. As followers of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Let us continue in prayer as we share the prayers of God's people. God, as we prepare to celebrate and give thanks this year, may we find it in our hearts to be grateful no matter what. May we praise you for what we can do and praise you in spite of what we can't. May we thank you for what is and what isn't, for what's going well and for what's not. May we thank you for what brings us joy and even for that which brings us grief. For if our grief testifies to anything, it testifies to the depths of our love. God, giver of all good, you continually pour your benefits upon us. Age after age, your people wait upon you and find that your faithfulness has no end, that your care is unfailing. We praise you that the mystery of life is a mystery of infinite goodness. For you created the heavens and earth, snails and gazelles, dandelions and roses, inchworms and kittens and heirloom tomatoes. You created kites and ocean waves, and all the hues of the color blue. For all your creations, we praise you for the order and constancy of nature, for the beauty and bounty of the earth, for day and night, summer and winter, seed time and harvest, for the varied gifts of loveliness which every season brings. We give you thanks for all the comfort and joys of life, for our homes, our families and friends, for all the love, sympathy, and goodwill of all people. We thank you, God, for everything we delight in, sunlight in autumn days, color in nature and art, rhythm in poetry and music, human achievement and family success, good humor, work well done, love and friendship, and all your gifts to body and soul. O God, lover of the world, you hold all that you've created within your compassionate embrace. As you hold our lives torn by pain, sorrow, or hatred within your aching heart, we cry out for wholeness for ourselves, for those we love, and for our world. May your healing presence gently transform the places of our lives where we hold pain. May your loving presence be a comforting reality for all those who find themselves in despair, lost or alone. May your transforming presence create generosity in place of greed, harmony in place of hatred, and everlasting justice where evil now reigns. We commend to you those who work in harsh conditions and those who have no work, those whose lives are drab and gray, those whose poor health takes away delight in living, those who are lonely, those who have no home of their own. Grant all the human help and comfort they need, and the spiritual encouragement enough to enable them to live with hope and courage. O God, lover of the world, we pray now as a community for the Georges family as they grieve the loss of their brother-in-law, Jim. We pray for Muriel, Jim, Marge, and Linda's friend Scott as they struggle with health challenges. We continue to pray for Janet, Judy, Penny, Anne, and Sue. We hold before you Terry, Lisa, and Kevin, Heather, and Brian, and Paul. We hold before you all who are grieving, all who are feeling depressed or overwhelmed or scared. God, from the silence of our own hearts, we bring before you people and places that need your healing, loving, transforming presence. O God, lover of the world, this is your world, and we claim your power and your presence to make it whole. Amen. We extinguish our candles as our time of worship concludes and our time of service begins. We return to our living and working amidst a world in need. As we go from this time, may we carry the light that burns with Christ's love in our hearts as we go out into God's world. As we leave this time of worship, may we be in the world showing a gentle attitude towards everyone we meet. May we be joyful and thankful, filling our minds with those things that are good and deserve praise, things true, noble, right, pure, lovely, and honorable. May we put into practice the word we've heard, our thoughts, and the stirrings of our hearts. May the God of all creation shower blessings and favor upon you. May the God of the harvest fill your loved ones with peace. May the God of salvation guide you all your days, and may God who gives peace be with you now and forever. Amen.